Last year, we shot a video how to pedal like a pro using our combined 40 plus years of experience of both riding and racing, plus the common wisdom that you should pedal in circles, i.e. dragging your heel through the bottom of the stroke and pulling up, etc.
But a lot of people responded in the comments section that this isn't in fact the most efficient way of pedaling. And it is true, there is a wealth of scientific evidence to say that a full pedal stroke isn't necessarily the most efficient. But I don't necessarily agree with some of these lab tests, and mainly because my perception is that I do in fact add force to the pedal stroke somewhere other than just the downstroke.
So we thought, how can we test this out the GCN way? Well, thankfully, one of the top sports science centres in the country here at the University of Bath have allowed us to do an experiment. Now, first things first, we do realise that this is not a completely legitimate scientific experiment. After all, Simon's the only person doing this, and according to what he just said, he's only going to do it once. What we do hope it will prove is, once and for all, whether, as Cy thinks, he is more efficient by pedalling around in circles using clipless pedals versus just pushing down. Either way, at least we get to put him through some pain. So the hypothesis is that pedalling around in circles is more efficient than simply pushing down. And to test this, he's in a very, very controlled environment. He's already doing the first of two 10-minute tests. At the moment, he's on a 6% incline here on the treadmill, riding at 20 kilometers per hour. And if I just look at the data, that requires around about 300 watts. And his heart rate at the moment is about 168, just over a minute through this first test. So once we get to the end of the 10 minutes, we're going to analyze various things. We're going to analyze the lactate in his blood. We're also going to analyze some of the things in his breath and also see heart rate, etc. as well. And then we're going to repeat the test, but this time we're going to use just flat pedals to try and eliminate anything which will enable him to pull through at the bottom of the stroke or even pull up, and then reanalyze all the same metrics at the end of that to come to a conclusion. Okay, Simon's only got 50 seconds left to go now. His heart rate is up to 175, so it's gradually risen. Almost time to start collecting some data through the breathing analysis and the blood lactate.
That which can't be done just yet.
What did you say your name was?
Now for the first heavy sniff.
Okay, well now we've swapped the pedals over for some standard flat ones with some normal mountain bike pedals, which Cy is riding on the treadmill now. Exactly the same conditions, we're on the same incline of 6% and the same speed of 20 kilometers per hour. Before we give you or even Cy some of the numbers from the last test or during this one, Cy, how is it actually feeling at the moment from your point of view?
Well, it's got to be said, it feels bloody weird. It does feel harder and it also feels much less smooth. I'm quite jerky on the treadmill, and that's my perception. So Johnson, I can't wait to see the numbers.
Right, well, you've still got 6 minutes left, and so we thought that in that time we'd answer a burning question that we had from the last time that we came here and used the treadmill. How is it that a treadmill, where effectively you're not moving anywhere, feels the same as when you're going up a climb, even though you're not gaining any potential energy? Well, thankfully we've got Jonathan here from the University of Bath who's going to explain. On the treadmill, we're not actually gaining any elevation, so why does it feel like we're still climbing?
I think what is a really good point is that we use the treadmill, so it's a really controlled environment. We can mimic, repeat the speed and the gradient, and there's no changes in environmental conditions, so everything is the same. Obviously, the athlete's not moving forwards or backwards, but they are riding against the rolling belt of the treadmill, and given the gradient as well, if they were to stop pedaling, they would come off for back. So we know that they are expending energy as they're going through. And also, as we recorded the power, we can see what power they're generating, and we know that's the same.
Okay, thanks very much. Right, well, I think Cy's close to ending his effort now, so let's go and see how he's getting on.
Yeah. Six, five, four, three, two,
one, zero. It's now 20 seconds left for Simon. Before we get all the official numbers, I can say that I've seen a slight difference here on my own Garmin. 10 seconds to go, Cy. Also important to note that we did allow Cy adequate time between the first test and this one before he went on the treadmill again to make sure he was completely rested. 2 seconds, 1 second, and stop. Okay, Jonathan, let's talk through some hard numbers. Simon's perceived exertion that he gave you at the end of the 10-minute test. For the first one, the Clipless pedals, it was 13. For the second one, it was 15. The heart rate I was looking at, the average over the last minute, was 180 for the flat pedals and 175 for the Clipless. In terms of the blood lactate which you took out at the end of both tests, how did that come out?
Surprisingly, it was actually the same. So 3.1 millimoles for both rides. So no difference at all, right. Seen there.
So that was similar. In terms of the gas analysis of the breath that you had, how did that come out?
Well, the VO2, which we recorded over the last 3 minutes, actually came out at slightly different values. So 51 millilitres per kilogram per minute for the flat pedals and 53 mils per kilogram per minute.
Wow, so he was consuming more oxygen with the Clipless pedals than he was with the flat pedals.
Yeah, so the Clipless pedals were actually eliciting a higher oxygen consumption.
So perhaps the opposite to what we were expecting. That's interesting. Okay, let's go and have a word with Si now that he's just recovered slightly and see how he feels about those results. Simon, Jonathan's just given us the results, and surprisingly, the flat pedals appear actually in this, you know, single test to be slightly more efficient than your Clipless pedals. So what do you make of that?
Well, yeah, I'm scratching my head a little bit, to be honest with you, Dan. I am surprised, but I've been thinking about it a little bit, and the main feeling is that when I was pedaling with the flat pedals, it felt like my shoe was almost always about to come off the pedal. But then the fact that it was almost coming off but not quite means that I suppose my natural pedaling style is one where I don't actually pull up, which I suppose I never really knew. But then if it's not adding anything, then presumably, arguably, it should be as efficient, if not more efficient, just using flat pedals. But I'm not going to throw away my Clipless pedals just yet because... Wow. Well, because for a start, I can't bunny hop without them. And then also, this is a steady state ride. And, you know, as you well know, even, you know, in a race situation, the amount of times we have to accelerate really hard, I know full well that I do pull up when I'm generating the most peak power that I can. And therefore, you know, in a normal environment, Clipless pedals are still going to be the ones that win out.
I guess that's the thing, isn't it? This laboratory here does take all external factors out, but when you're racing or training on the road, you have all of those external factors. Anyway, stay tuned to GCN because we're going to be coming back here to the University of Bath to do more experiments with myself and Si on this treadmill, which should help to answer a lot of your burning questions.
For more GCN Does Science videos, click on me. And yes, Luke, I am your father.